You've heard of paper straws and cups, but how about a paper battery? One that you can compost when you're done with it. Two companies are already proving that it works, and one of them with a battery that runs on sugar. So how did humble paper become a next generation battery material? And could these compostable batteries actually replace the ones we use today? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Ground News. I love my smart home sensors around my house, but swapping out disposable batteries every few months? Not so much. I make the trek to a recycling center a couple of times a year, but let's be real. Most batteries don't get that treatment. More than half of all portable batteries still end up in the trash. And while lithium battery recycling is really picking up, many people don't know where to drop them off. That means hundreds of thousands of tons of batteries go into landfills each year, which is a major environmental hazard. And while there have been major advances in battery recycling and making batteries less toxic overall, the reality is that most are still an environmental hazard. Common battery materials like cadmium, cobalt, copper, lead, lithium, and nickel are super toxic and seep into the soil, streams, and groundwater. Now, if recycling isn't guaranteed and landfill batteries pose serious risks, how can we make a battery that goes easier on the environment? Turns out paper's technological revolution didn't stop at books. It's now a key ingredient in a new generation of compostable batteries. Paper fibers are mostly cellulose, a structural material plants use to reinforce their cell walls, providing the strength to stand as tall as 115 meters or 380 feet, like a redwood tree, while staying flexible enough to bend in high winds without snapping. Cellulose is the most abundant natural polymer on Earth, made up of long chains of sugar molecules. And if that's not sweet enough, cellulose isn't just renewable, it's also biodegradable. Researchers are exploring greener materials for electronics and leveraging wood's unique structural properties to even create a wooden satellite, which I talk about in another video. They're also developing printed paper circuit boards and even wood-based electrical transistors. And now two startups are pushing paper's potential even further, using it as a backbone for two radically different battery designs. Based in France, Bioenzymatic Fuel Cells a la Paper, or BEFC, aims to replace the ubiquitous button battery with a paper-based compostable alternative. Their design uses carbon electrodes and electrical contacts, avoiding metals entirely. And they can do that because technically their innovation isn't a traditional battery. It's a bioenzymatic fuel cell that runs on sugar, just like the rest of us, or in my wife's case, a lot of candy. So how does BEFC's bio battery actually work? Well, between its electrodes is a layer of paper infused with sugars and enzymes. When activated by moisture, like by squeezing a blister pack of water, the enzymes break down sugar on the anode, releasing both electrons and protons. The electrons travel through an external circuit, generating electricity, while at the cathode, oxygen from the air reacts with incoming protons and electrons to form water. It completes the reaction. By mimicking biological energy generation, BEFC has created a lower waste button battery alternative that won't leak toxic battery juices or heavy metals like conventional batteries, even if it ends up in the trash. There's a catch though. BEFC's bio battery only outputs about 0.75 volts, so it's not replacing a 1.5 volt AA battery anytime soon. The company's instead aiming to have its batteries built right into one-time use items like medical devices or cold chain shipping tags that monitor the location or temperature. This fills a crucial gap in sustainable power, but we still need an environmentally friendly, compostable solution for higher powered and even rechargeable consumer batteries. That's where Flint comes in. Now, I stumbled upon them at CES this year. A lot of us grow up hoping to someday change the world for the better, but after a childhood witnessing natural disasters that are worsened by climate change, Carlo Charles wasn't willing to wait for someday. While still a student at Nanyang Technological University in Singapore, he co-founded a startup called Flint to commercialize a rechargeable battery with a lower environmental footprint, developed by two of his professors, Suku Li and Hongjin Fan. Li and Fan both knew that paper is an ideal separator between a battery's electrodes because its rough, porous texture provides a large surface for ion exchange, and its absorbent fibers soak up battery juices like a sponge, enhancing conductivity. Now, the catch is that you can't just print an anode and cathode metal onto opposite sides of a piece of paper because the battery will short circuit through those pores. So Li and Fan infused the paper with hydrogel to create a super thick, flexible sheet of paper onto which they could directly print electrode metals front and back. That makes paper, yes, just regular old paper, the backbone of this battery, the electrode separator, and even the electrolyte once it's soaked up enough of the battery juice. So it sounds good on paper, but how did it perform? Well, that depends on who's telling the story. Breakthroughs like this often make headlines, but how they're reported can vary wildly depending on the source. Some might highlight the eco-friendly potential, while others focus on the challenges. That's why I think it's crucial to get a well-rounded view, something like Ground News, that makes this even easier than ever. Created by a former NASA engineer, Ground News gathers news from over 50,000 sources, analyzing political bias, credibility, and even financial incentives behind the coverage. A great example is this story about scientists rallying in DC against Trump's proposed research cuts. With one click, I can see a summary, political bias, ownership details, and a factuality breakdown of every source covering it. For instance, a center-leaning source presents it as a straightforward report. It states the event and its purpose without adding judgment. Meanwhile, a left-leaning source takes a more critical stance, framing Trump as an aggressor and scientists as victims of a politically motivated attack. And a right-leaning source questions the rally's intent, implying the event was more about politics than actual scientific advocacy. As someone who watches my videos, you probably like digging deeper into the facts to understand the bigger picture. Ground News makes it easy to compare coverage, spot bias, and see the full story. One of my favorite features is the blind spot feed, which reveals stories underreported by one side of the political spectrum. It's helped me to recognize blind spots and to see the nuance in different stories. For a limited time, you can get the same plan I use at nearly half the price. Just go to ground.news/undecided or scan the QR code to save 40% on their Vantage plan. I only promote brands I trust, and I think you'll find Ground News just as valuable as I do. Thanks to Ground News and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to how the battery actually performed. It achieved volumetric and power densities more than twice as high as many other flexible zinc-based batteries at the time, with a charge-discharge efficiency over 95%. Unfortunately, the batteries didn't cycle well, with performance dropping to just a quarter of the original after 500 cycles. Still, Charles was determined to make sure that the paper-based battery made it out of the lab and into everyday devices. And ever since, Flint has been improving on Fan and Lee's original design, raising the charge-discharge efficiency to 99.8%. Flint is now achieving gravimetric and volumetric energy densities of 226 watt-hours per kilogram and 410 watt-hours per liter, which is comparable to some lithium-ion batteries, even though it uses zinc and carbon black anodes in a manganese dioxide cathode. That's a chemistry similar to alkaline batteries, meaning they share the same nominal 1.5 volts, allowing Flint's batteries to serve as drop-in replacements. But Flint's design stands out in two key ways. First, the company claims its water-based electrolyte isn't hazardous like the potassium hydroxide that's used in alkaline batteries. Second, and this is crucial, Flint's batteries can now endure 1,000 charge cycles before their capacity drops to 80%, putting their long-term performance on par with many lithium-ion technologies. That translates to about 5 to 6 years of use in everyday products before the battery sees the inside of a garbage bin, or hopefully a recycling center, but most likely the trash. That's why it helps that the paper backbone of these batteries is compostable, breaking down in soil within just 6 weeks. Flint is also exploring compostable casings for future models, but for now, the company's priority is bringing the greener chemistry to market, and that means sticking with industry standard casings. Ideally though, the steel casings, aluminum tabs, and zinc anode would be recycled before the manganese cathode and hydrogel reinforced paper were thrown to the worms. Because although zinc and manganese are abundant minerals with smaller extraction footprints than lithium, at least according to S&P Global, mining always carries an ecological and human cost. Still, if these batteries do end up in a landfill, they've at least sidestepped the most toxic metals found in consumer batteries like cobalt and nickel. Safety is enhanced as well. Paper doesn't rely on a flammable electrolyte like lithium-ion batteries, which eliminates the risk of catastrophic fires if punctured, submerged, or overheated. Flint says its batteries operate safely across impressive temperature ranges of negative 20 degrees Celsius to 80 degrees Celsius, far beyond the 15 degrees Celsius to 35 degrees Celsius sweet spot of lithium-ion cells. That makes them not just safer, but also more reliable in extreme conditions, whether baking in the sun or freezing in the cold. Now to start, Flint is reaching for the low-hanging fruits of coin cells and pouch batteries, but they have plans to tackle the first cylindrical cells like the double and triple A's that fill our junk drawers next year. The company is also looking to scale up for backup power and energy storage systems. By wiring 8 pouch cells in a series with a battery management system, Flint can create a 12-volt battery just like a typical lead-acid car battery, but 30% lighter thanks to its higher gravimetric energy density. Mobility though? That's a jumpstart beyond the battery's current power. A greener zinc-based chemistry may never pack the same punch as a lithium and cobalt powering EVs. However, there are plenty of applications that don't need quite as much oomph. Flint's flexible paper-based cells could slip into devices that move with your body, fold into compact tech, or even mold to a device's curved frame. The bottom line, you may have a wearable biomedical device with paper someday, but probably won't be driving a paper-powered car anytime soon. So what does all this safety and sustainability cost? Well, Flint claims that its batteries are 1.8 times cheaper per kilowatt hour compared to lithium-ion chemistries, and they might cost as little as $50 per kilowatt hour once they're at full scale production. That scale up from laboratory to startup to first production run is happening fast. In 2023, Charles told TechCrunch, "I went to a battery plant recently and they have a big slurry machine where you put in the powders to turn them into a liquid form. And they run that huge machine, which is almost half the size of my room, and they run it 12 hours just to make one slurry component. Do you know what we do to make our batteries? We use an egg beater and we beat it for 3 hours with our hands. And our numbers are decent even with all that. Imagine if we had the resources and facilities." Just over a year later, in December of 2024, Flint secured $2 million in seed funding to bring its technology to market, with plans to begin pilot production mid-2025, right around the corner. That's great news because decades of effort doesn't seem to have brought up recycling levels above 50%. Rechargeable and compostable technologies may be the greener way forward for consumer batteries, especially as we add more electronic devices to our daily lives. And with companies like Flint and BEFC bringing real solutions to market soon, change is on the horizon. In the meantime, don't let your dead batteries pile up. Drop them off for recycling. In the US, Call to Recycle offers a free locator tool to help you find nearby recycling centers. But what do you think? Would you ever feel comfortable tossing a battery into the compost? Got an idea to boost recycling rates? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to listen to my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, while I keep this conversation going. Thanks as always to my patrons for your continued support and helping to keep the channel going. Keep your mind open, stay curious, and I'll see you in the next one.